the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. In the multitude of your tender mercies, prepare our hearts that we may enter into your house to study your word and to confess your holy name with right words and good deeds that flow from your Holy Spirit. Through your holy name, through Jesus Christ, my God and our Lord. Amen. Okay, so we're going to look at one, and it's going to bleed into another that we'll do next week. But I want to start with 666. And I think what I've told you in the past and what you are probably remembering was when I was at school for my doctorate, last winter or the winter before, I'm not sure which one, I had Cantor Richard Resch. Cantor is a German word for something. For choir director. It's choir director, but I don't know the exact translation, but it sounds important, so I call him that. And he was the head cantor at CTS when I was there. Well, he's since retired. His son's moved away, and so I called him up just the other day, and he had, during the, nobody got that? Okay. It was Cat Stevens. Was it Cat Stevens or was it?
Yes. I mentioned it.
Yeah. Cats in the Cradle? Ah. Yes. All right. No, it wasn't Cat Stevens. Jim Croce. See, we tackle the tough issues here at Augustana. No, it's not Jimmy Buffett. I can assure you that. Yeah, Harry Chapin. Okay. Well, I went with that, and you were all like, It just got it awkward because I didn't call him and I didn't know where to go. Anyway, so I was in his class. And we were going through the hymns because it was all about hymnody. The whole class was, and I've always wondered. And he was on the hymn council committee with Dr. Paul Grimm, who is now the dean of the chapel at CTS and a wonderful guy. And I've always wondered if they put this hymn on page 666 on purpose. O little flock, fear not the foe. And so finally I said, I'm going to get a definitive answer. I'm going to get a yes or no. I'm finally going to get to answer the man or ask the man. So whenever we came around to these hymns and my mind started to wander, my hand shot up like yours did. And he said, yes, Gavin, what do you think? And I said, I don't know what you're talking about, but I have a question. I said, I've wondered this forever, and I need a definitive answer. Is O Little Flock, Fear Not the Foe, being on page 666, done on purpose? I need a definitive answer. And so he answers me, what do you think? And then he moved on. But I do think I got my answer, but I thought that was pretty... I need to know this. What do you think? I think yes. Okay, then. But I do think that's pretty cool and one of the neatest things that they did in this hymnal. Please note Concordia Publishing House that I'm complimenting the hymnal. But they did do a really good work, and it's full of things like this. And of course, the one that I always give credit for is the Bible citations in the liturgy. Love that, as well as the Bible citations in our hymns. You ever look at that? Do you ever notice those? Because that's what we're going to look at today, so we'll look a little closer. Does everybody know the tune? Enough that we can kind of carry. You can do what Pastor does, Danny, and fear not the foe. You know, yeah, you do that. So let's go ahead and sing through the first one just to get the tune in our head, and then we'll look at the theology behind it. I want to make sure that I get somebody have a harmonica. Harmonica. Oh, I know the piano, but I don't know which key to hit.
It's
oh, is that written on there? Because nope, there's no E on there. This is the one I know. That's middle C because it's in the middle. That's... You mean when I brought my computer in here to play, you could have been doing this? I know it's right. Did you know she could do that? No, see, this is new to me. I'm sure it's the sheet music. I'm sure she's right. No, sorry. That was something that I was not expecting. Yeah. Oh, little flock, fear not the foe who madly seeks your overthrow. Dread not his rage and power. And though your courage sometimes faints, he seeming triumphs o'er God's saints. Last but a little hour. Okay, so before we get into the scripture, I want to look at the tense and the tone of voice, not the tone of voice, who's speaking and who is being spoken to. So what is the tense? T-E-N-S-E. Yes, it is in the present tense, and that is important. So anytime you sing this song,
it's now.
Yeah, exactly. So it's not, oh, by the way, you didn't need to worry, but now you do, 'cause what's coming up, you know? but it's all in the present tense. So, and also, who is speaking? The hymn writer. The hymn writer is speaking to... Nope. And we're going to look at that. We're going to look at that in a bit. I'm glad you said that, Linda. We are going to look at something like that. And that's actually why I'm bringing this up. But if we look to number two, be of good cheer, your cause belongs to him who can avenge your wrongs. Leave it to him, our Lord. So therefore, it can't be God speaking, because of the tense and the person. So it is the hymn writer. It can also be seen as those singing the hymn singing to one another. So one of those two ways. So if Sam and Linda were singing, were the only two singing. Sam would be singing to Linda, and Linda would be probably fussing at Sam. Singing to Sam. So we're gonna. So that's important. Tense and who is speaking and who is being comforted are very important. So Jacob Fabricius could be the one speaking, or it can be you singing to each other, us singing to one another. And I'm okay with believing either one of those, to be honest. Let's look at Luke 12. And you have, I don't have, but you have. Bible's room. I'm not going through verse.
Luke 12:32.
See, I shouldn't have told y'all my secret.
Second Luke,
yeah. See, now, because the first two classes, I just used the scripture at the bottom and didn't tell y'all. Now I've given you my secret, which is great, because actually, you can look, as we sing these songs, you can actually look at the texts and record them and go back and re-sing the hymn and look at the text, the biblical text in which they were created, drawn out of. First, let's look at Luke 2. By the way, what is the beginning of Luke best known for?
The doctrine.
Hmm?
The doctrine.
Well, that's true. That's true. But what else? Yes, the story of Jesus' birth. The Lukean account of Jesus' birth is the one that it's the one that it's very difficult to not read in the King James. You know what I mean? It's the traditional, the one that in the historic lectionary, the 1 year lectionary readings is every single year. So beginning at Luke 2, you have what? In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered or taxed. This is the first registration when Quirinius, the governor of Syria, was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. She gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no place for him at the inn. Now, what do we see at the second, at chapter 8? I'm sorry, verse 8. No, verse 8. Maggie, I'm sorry, that's my fault. First Huckabees. Luke 2, verse 8. Okay, so you have angels and shepherds. Okay. Then what? Keep going down to the next section at 22. Okay, presented to the temple. Now, that's where I'm going to read here. Can anybody just as a memory work without looking at the Bible, tell me what happens at the temple?
When
not baptized, but yeah.
And the prophet was there, and he was God excited because he was sitting
across. And do you remember the prophet's name? Anyone? Simeon. It's Simeon. And what, I was going to ask this question, but you already answered it. What was Simeon famous for? That the Holy Spirit had come upon him and told him that he would not die until he sees the Lord's Christ. Okay? So, I have no idea how old he is, but we can assume that he's pretty old. There's a strong possibility that he was actually a fixture in the temple and that he was expecting and wanting to see the Christ child so that he could depart in peace, so he could die. It doesn't say this, but I always imagined that he is very old and that he keeps coming to the temple because he's like, I don't want to do this anymore. And so finally, here come Mary and Joseph with their baby. And Simeon takes Christ into his hands, and what does it say he does? Blesses them. We're going to start at 27. And he came in the spirit into the temple, And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to him, according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, "Now let your servant depart in peace according to thy word. For my eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light to reveal you to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel." Now, what's that called, first of all, liturgically? Well, it's not after the service. It's the Song of Simeon or the Nunc Dimittis. It's after communion. Yeah, is that what you meant by service? You mean, yeah, okay.
That's the last thing part of it we sing before.
After the second service.
Blessed and we go on.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. Now, let's stop with what you just said. It happens at the end of something. You're correct. Both of you guys kind of helped each other out. But what is it at the end of? So what have you just beheld? What have you just beheld? Yeah, exactly. Until I see the Lord's Christ, I shall not die. This is my body. This is my blood. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace. My eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people. And so right here, we are little Simeons receiving the Christ in full body, in full blood, rising and leaving. And so then we must ask, what, dear flock, do you have to fear if you're willing to come up from this altar and say, "I can die now"? There's nothing left to fear, right? I have received the Lord's Christ. I'm ready to die. That is the confession of a Christian. I can die knowing that I have seen the Lord. And not only have I seen Him, I have tasted Him. And I have digested Him, and He is in me, and I in Him, right? The vine understanding. I can't think of the. Well, anyways, so then we get to the actual part that is quoted in here. Would someone like to read at verse 32-ish? Oh, no, I'm sorry.
It's
12. It is 12, isn't it?
You're not little flock, but it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom.
Wait, can you say that, the last part, one more time? If you're not little flock.
For it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom.
And this works right in with the Song of Simeon as well, doesn't it? That it is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. I cannot remember the name of that girl who is in Syria, I believe, who is on her last appeal, or is it Aleppo? Maybe it's not Aleppo. Aleppo's in Syria, I know, but there's a girl who's a Christian who is exhausting her last appeal to be destroyed, to be killed. And I think about that and how you don't fear. And how do you not fear that? Because not only are you, I mean, we all picture ourselves dying in, at least I hope, dying in our beds of just exhaustion. In other words, we have a full life, fall asleep, we wake up in heaven. I mean, that's what we all want. And that's what I want for every Christian. Rarely do we have to face the sword. And so I wonder how many of us could face the sword that way, and how many of us would say, I'm a member of the flock. It is my Father's good pleasure to give to me the kingdom. O little flock, fear not the foe who madly seeks your overthrow. Dread not his rage and power. What is that? What other hymn does that remind you of? We did it a mighty fortress. Yep. One little word can fail him. What seems so monstrous here on earth is but a minuscule amount of power that Satan has compared to the peace that is in Christ Jesus, who is whom we flock, our good shepherd. Okay, now once again we hear that we are being spoken to, or speaking to one another, at verse 2. Be of good cheer, your cause belongs to him who can avenge your wrongs. Leave it to him, our Lord. Though hidden yet from mortal eyes, his Gideon shall for you arise, uphold you and his word. And then we will look, actually let's go to the third stanza. As true is God's own word is true, not earth or hell, satanic crew, against us shall prevail. Their might a joke, a mere facade, God is with us, and we with God. Our victory cannot fail. And this is why I wanted to skip to that, or move on to that verse, because it's exactly what I said. You know, that when we think of Satan, and we think of death, and we think of the devil, and we think of all of the hordes of demons, it's enough to shake us to our core. And Hollywood has not ceased to capitalize on this, right? I mean, you see all these movies of monsters and Satan, who is huge and scary, perforated tongue, and forked tongue, perforated tail, and you know, it really. He's dressed up with a $6 costume from, you know, Halloween store. But that's, in reality, that's not how Scripture shows him. How does Scripture show him? Beautiful. Attractive. And that's the thing about sin. You know, in the garden, Satan didn't show up and say, eat this, and then put it in her mouth. You know, he was cunning. He was beautiful. Yeah, he was a smooth talker. In fact, all he did was present in such a way something that she found attractive already. What did she say? When she saw that the fruit was good for eating. Now notice the words there. When she saw that the fruit was good for eating. It does not say when she saw that the fruit was good for her soul, or when she saw that the fruit was good for her body, or boy, there aren't any empty calories in that, or whatever that we say nowadays. She saw that it was good for eating. In other words, insatiable, right? That she desired to eat it because of what she saw. What is that? Let's take and sit, I'm going to use men as the bad guys in this example. But what about 90% of the commercials on the during the Super Bowl? Well, it is.
Beer.
It is beer too. But, oh, it is Clydesdales as well, but the Clydesdales are yeah, puppies are good. I'm afraid I'm going to bring your sanctification level down a little bit here, Danny. Bikini-clad ladies.
I didn't notice.
You didn't notice that. How to maintain a successful marriage right there. That's like point one through ten. but you know, sex sells, but... You know, people say that sex sells, but that's not really true. Lust sells, right? I mean, a sexual relationship between a husband and wife, that is good and pleasing to God, right? I mean, that's why He created sex within the marital bounds. But what sells is lust. And so when we take the fruit from Eve and we switch it to bikini-clad women for men on this side of Eden, yeah, then it's you're like, well, that's not really a fair comparison. Well, it actually is. Compared to her sinless state, when she saw, oh, God told me not to eat that, but that looks so good. And we over here, yes, I'm going to do it, when the men say, well, I know I'm not supposed to look at that, but it looks so good. And that lust takes it. Thank you, Sam. I was trying to actually get through it, you know, like a teacher in sex ed, but you went. I love having Sam in class.
And then you
had a six. Yeah. Yeah. You had a six pack. And or you have a six pack and then that commercial comes on. It, well, pretty much. It was high school, wasn't it? Which is about the same thing. You're basically living in a beer commercial on the Super Bowl, right? I love Wednesday's studies. But I mean, it is the same. You know, she saw that it was good for eating, and so she hungered over it. Since then, we have seen that sin is good for a good time. And so we go after it, right? Whether it's lust, whether it's jealousy, whether it's coveting, whether it's slander. Why do people slander? I mean, have you ever thought about that? Why do we, I don't want to say people as if they're out there and we're safe in here. Why do we slander? I don't believe that we slander to actually hurt the person. Yeah. You slander people so that the person you're talking to will exchange something with you, right? Trust.
Fist.
Yeah. Cool points. You know. Oh yeah, but Gavin, you know, when he first got here, he didn't comb his hair. Well, that's actually true. That's not a good example. Huh? I've never worn Argyle socks.
There was one minister, Pastor Witt, who died a long time ago. He preached for us for a while. He said his first pastor, that they ran him off because he wore Argyle socks. Holy cow! You know, that was what their complaint was. So, I mean, it's the same thing.
Well, I mean, if that was the complaint, and it was serious enough, at that point, you just have to hand him over to the prince of this earth and say, there's nothing anyone can say to them. You are sinners, yet Christ have died for you. Shut up, you're wearing Argyle socks. You know, that doesn't make any sense, you know. But where was I going with that? Oh, why do people slander? You know, people don't necessarily always slander to hurt that person. In fact, slander is a lie. Gossip can have truth to it, right? Slander is a lie. For example, I'm trying to use myself, but I was really relying on the hair combing thing, and now that's gone. Chewbacca? I don't know. I can't think of any examples. But you know, that you would lie about someone in order to look better in someone else's eyes. That's what slander is. And it seems like such a little thing. But behind it is a snare of Satan. Right? I mean, it's enticing to us for a reason. And it's enticing to us for the same reason that the fruit was enticing to Eve. And likewise for Adam. And so even on, but yet my point being is that even on this side, on this side of heaven, those things seem so big, that Satan seems so big and so beautiful and as if we stand no chance. Because if Satan is either and or both a scary lion crouching around, prowling around, looking to devour you. By the way, where did I use that? Where does that example come from? The Bible. The Bible. Or he's beautiful, enticing, and the serpent in the garden. Are those options? They're not options, right? Both are true. And so then we have to ask, well, what chance do we have? Because on this side of heaven, it seems like we're not going to get out of it alive. Right? Satan is everywhere. Satan is not everywhere, but we're not going to get into that yet. We will later. It seems like Satan and his demons are constantly after us and that we have no hope. And if you live in darkness forever, let's say you live in a dark cave and you have food and you have shelter and you have everything you need, what's the one thing you want?
A bathroom.
We have that too.
Sunshine.
Yeah, but light, right? The one thing that you want is light. Well, in this world where it seems like Satan is constantly at the attack and constantly after us, what's the one thing that we need? The gospel. In a world full of darkness, we need light. And so we go back to Luke, right? John. When Christ was the light who came into the world and was the light of men. And then that light was extinguished, right? There's a reason why Good Friday is black. But that wasn't the end. So when we're here at the third stanza, as true men, as true as God's own word is true. So I love that part, because what does it say? Do you believe God's word is true? Okay, then you're going to believe what this next part says is true. Not earth nor hell's satanic crew against us shall prevail. And now all of a sudden the coin has been flipped. Right? Here we're sitting here going, there's no way we can get out of it alive. Satan and his demons and sin and death and my family leaving me and going into who knows what. What chance do I have here? And then all of a sudden we're going, Satan and his satanic crew. What does the rest of it say? Against us cannot or shall not, against us shall prevail. Not earth nor hell's satanic crew against us shall prevail. And so it's been flipped on its end to, oh my God, God has left us, to, oh my God, God has died and risen for me. There's nothing that can hurt me. mean, isn't that the true gospel? I mean, that Christ would die and that we would be, and that he would be, by dying and by rising, he would be our good shepherd, and we would know his voice, and we would know him, and we would follow him. And so, and as long as we hear his voice, his word preached to us, eaten at the sacrament of the altar and washed in the sacrament of holy baptism, as well as at absolution, confession, absolution. And that's why you can't worship God on the ninth hole. I know you guys get tired of hearing me say that, but I'm not going to stop. Because you need to be where God has promised himself to be. Where has God promised himself to be? In his holy house. Lord, I love the habitation of the habitation of your house. And how nicely you have cut the greens today. No, that's not what it says. I'm not just picking on you, Sam. I know you're in here every Sunday, except that one time you called me about at the beach and had a question about that. But I've forgiven you. We can move on. Just need a reminder sometimes. Is it against me? Then you're slandering me to yourself. Okay, and then verse 4. And then this becomes that we are praying, right? We are the ones praying. Will you give me the I messed up the last time. Will you give me is it, Amen, Lord Jesus, grant us prayer. Great captain, now thine arm make bare. Fight for us once again. So shall thy saints, almighty chorus to thy praise, forevermore, amen. These notes threw me off. Yeah, these notes threw me off. I was singing just fine. The notes changed. You know, it's funny because I know we make these videos for our members, but I'm sure that there are other people who watch them and they go, man, you just sang three verses. How did you mess up the fourth one? Don't judge me. That prayer becomes our prayer, that we would pray that Christ would bear his arm and would show us what he has done, constantly reminding us what he has done, that he has overcome sin, death, and the devil, and that they have been driven away, and that in regards to Christ, not even the gates of hell can overcome it. And then, when we look at hymn number 594, and then we look at verse 3, let me know when you're there. At verse 3, you see a reversal here. It's not talking about Satan. It's talking to Satan. And this is one of the best stanzas I love. Satan, hear this proclamation. I am baptized into Christ. Drop your ugly accusation. I am not so soon enticed. Now that to the font I've traveled, all your might has come unraveled. And against your tyranny, God my Lord unites with me. That's what I love about this hymn. The theology is outstanding. And that's all I'll say for now until next week, because we're going to look at this hymn next week. But look at that, how we speak to Satan. And so we who were afraid of Satan and who were saying, look at how scary that he is and look at how enticing he is, and then by the gospel, by baptism, by what Christ's death and resurrection, we turn and we say that, we turn and we say, you can't prevail over us. Right? From scared to confident and confessional, in that we say, Christ is our Lord, God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and so through the Apostles' Creed. And so now, not only are we not hiding or running scared, we see here in stanza 3 that we're actually telling Satan to take a hike. Satan, hear this proclamation. I am baptized into Christ. You can go ahead and drop your ugly accusation. I am not so soon enticed, because to the font I've traveled. Now all of your might has come unraveled. And so against your tyranny, Christ my Lord, or God, what is it, Christ my Lord, or God my Lord, has united with me. What more is there to say there? I mean, it's very difficult to trump that baptismal verse. And so we will end in prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All Christians who have been baptized, who know the God of heaven, and in whose daily life is prized the name of Christ once given, consider now what God has done, the gifts he gives to everyone baptized into Christ Jesus. Use it well, you are made new, in Christ a new creation, as faithful Christians live and do within your own vocation, until that day when you possess his glorious robe of righteousness bestowed on you forever. Amen.